rivers declares your majesty. You are holy.
Good afternoon, Feruz.
Good afternoon, Abba. Can you hear me?
Xavier Mesgan, we will pass to your first selection after this hymn, okay?
Yes.
Good.
All right.
We will start with the sign of the cross. I will stop this and we will immediately go to yeah. Yes. Good afternoon, good afternoon. I think they are starting to enter even some people. So can we start with the sign of the cross and go ahead with the first hymn which you have selected? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm going to pray especially for our young people. We offer to you, loving God, the gifters and the needers of our youth. Bless them with your guiding grace as they face the challenges and the opportunities in their lives. Touch their hearts with the gentleness of your love, that they may know they are valued and valuable beings. Send your spirit of hope in their lives, that they may believe in themselves and know they are needed in this world. Grace them with the gifts of joy and hope, that they may celebrate life through laughter and tears alike. Guide us as we continue to grow in appreciation of many gifts of young people, in the ministry opportunities we offer to them, in the journey of life we walk with them, in our shared mission as a community called to discipleship in the world. We ask you, Lord Jesus, to bless all our catechists, especially for Feruz and Sarah, who are going to lead. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you, Feruz. Yeah, do you want to share the first hymn? Or I think it is good if we go to the first hymn, which you sent in the YouTube.
Sin behind the selfishness of hearts I entertain, your faithfulness remains, I trust in you.
Thank you, wonderful hymn. So thank you so much. So we can go ahead and I will be around.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, FERUZ, and all those who are participated today. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Abba. Thank you for the blessings and thank you for the prayer and thank you for the amazing hymns that we've been hearing. Hi, everyone. How are you doing? How is everyone doing? I trust the Lord that we are all doing fine with His grace and mercy. Ruta, I see you. Hi, and Betu and Naomi, I also see you. How are you? So today we will be going through, can you all hear me clearly? Or is my voice low? Do you want me to add more volume? Let me know.
We can hear you.
Okay, perfect. So today we will be going through our third part seminar on the who am I in the sight of God. So if you do remember, unfortunately last week we didn't have our, it was supposed to be last week our third part on this very topic, but unfortunately we were forced to cancel the session. But the two sessions that we had before that were dealing with the same topic we've started, right? So on the very first topic, when we first started this catechism, we tackled the topic of who am I in the sight of God? But this is the second one, but the first one was, who is God to me, right? Who is Jesus to me? How do I see him? And we looked through it. We try to identify, to analyze, to see, to understand, to learn the identity of Christ, what he means to us, who he is to us, to each and every single one of us individually and then in general as well. And then now for the second part of the seminar, we are looking, okay, if this is God to me, if this is who Jesus is to me, then for me, how does God see me? Who am I then in the sight of God? Or who am I for God? Who am I, right? And this is a very important question, and it's a question that many teenagers go through, and it's a very important question that we need to look into, because when you start to grow, you start to get into your 17s, 18s years old, and as you grow, you start to think like, okay, where do I come from? Who am I? Who made me? Who is responsible for me? Where am I going? What is the purpose of my life? What am I doing here on earth? You are puzzled with all of these questions, and some of them you don't find answer, and some of them you do. But lucky enough, we are blessed enough to know that we have a God that created us, that made us in his own image, and that we are, before anything else, creatures made in the image of God. When God created everything, right? Everything. He made the tree, he made the mountains, he made the fish, he made all the different types of animals. But above everything else, from all his creations, there is one creation he made only in his own image, and that is us, as human beings. We are made in the image of God. No other creation in this earth has the image of God except us. So we do represent the beauty, the goodness, and the splendor of God on this earth. And that's what we first tackled on the first week of this seminar topic, who am I in the sight of God? And going from there, then we looked into, okay, if I am the only creation made in the image of God, right? If I'm the only one that have the image of God, then I should belong to God, right? Then what type of belongingness do I have to God? What type of relationship I have with God? If he made me in his image, then who does he call me? Who am I to him? How does he call me? How does he refer to me? And then we looked at, he refers to us as his children. We are his children. If our parents made us, we look like some part of us look like our mother and some part of us look like our father, right? In our nose or in our eyes, we may look like our father, and in our hair or in our behavior and our personality, we may look like our mother, right? We resemble our parents the same exact way. If we are made in the image of God, then we resemble his image. That means we are then to be called his children. So we are his daughters and his sons. So God, when he looks at us, he sees our sins, he sees all our shortcomings, he sees all our weaknesses, but beyond anything else, he sees himself in us, he sees his face in us, and he sees his children in us. And that's why on the second week, we meditated that we are the children of God, right? So we call Father, Abba, Father. That's how we refer to him. And today we're going to then take it to another level. Okay, if I'm made in the image of God, if I'm the only creation made in the image of God, if I'm the only creation that has the right to call God my father, then who else am I to God? How do I belong to God? What other belongingness do I have to God? How does he see me? When he sees me, what does he see in me? Who am I in his sight? And we are going to take it a little bit deeper and a little bit more farther than what we already have. We are the disciples of God, meaning we are called to be disciples of Jesus Christ, right? When Jesus Christ came, he came to save us. He came to restore us. He came to put us back to our place, a place that we have lost because of Adam and Eve, right? He came to restore to us through his blood. Now, for everyone else, for us to learn about this good news, what does Jesus say? You are my disciples. You are going to serve my kingdom. You are going to go all over the world and witness the goodness of my work, the gospel. What does gospel mean? Gospel means the gospel of John, the gospel of Matthew, the gospel of Mark, the gospel of Luke. What do they mean? What does gospel mean? It means the good news, right? The good news that Jesus Christ brought, the salvation, the eternal life, the love in God. All of this good news, we are called to tell it to people. And guess what? We don't have necessarily to tell it with our words. If we are courageous enough, if we are brave enough, we can say, hey, God loves you. Jesus Christ died for you, right? But beyond that, we are called to witness with our lives, right? Our lives are called to witness that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. In fact, for today, we are going to be taking, looking at verse 19 and 20 from Matthew, from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, what Jesus Christ tells to his disciples, right? He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. So in this one, what is Jesus Christ asking his disciples to do? He had 12 disciples, right? He picked them, he chose them, and he said, you are going to go all over the world, and you are going to bring all this good news to everyone and to tell them that I came to die for them, that I came to restore them, that I came to put them back to their right place, and to reconcile them with the Father. And with this, you will make them my disciples. So when Jesus Christ look at us through baptism, we become the children of God, but we also become the disciples of Jesus Christ. And Holy Spirit starts to live within us. So when we are baptized, when our mother and our father take us to the church, what happens then is we automatically become the children of God, of Father, right? And we automatically become disciples of Jesus Christ, right? We are the now to go and witness and tell all this good news. And we also become the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is what we're going to be looking at next week. So last week we looked into that we become the children of the Father. This week we are looking at that we also become now, through our baptism, the disciples of Jesus Christ. And then next week we are going to look at what do we become. We become also the temple, or the place where Holy Spirit resides, where Holy Spirit lives, dwells. And we will look into that on the next week in depth. So today I want us to focus on, okay, we became children of God because we are in his image, but through baptism we also became his disciples. So we are the disciple of Jesus Christ. How amazing is that? What does a disciple mean? So I'm going to read through you for you a section from a sermon that I took from San Bishop Kevin that gave on his St. Louis Besançon Parish. And he talks here about discipleship. What does it mean to be an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ? What does it mean? When Jesus looks at us, he sees disciples in us. But what does that mean? When Jesus looks at me, he sees a disciple of him, meaning a follower of him. And so he expects me to go and tell the good news, to go and witness the good news, the gospel with my life, right? It's good if I can witness it with my words, But more than anything else, I should be able to witness the gospel, the good news, what Jesus Christ has done to me with my life, right? So this one, he tries to explain it in this very short words, which I will take and pass it to you. Living as intentional disciples challenge us every day in our relationships, in our decisions, and in our school life, and in our work. We are challenged by the gospel, the words, and the life of Jesus Christ, right? To be an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ means living life with a purpose. That purpose, as the Catechism says, it is to know, to love, and to serve God in this life and to be happy with Him forever in the next. Our purpose should not be to accumulate wealth or to strive for fame and celebrity. When we have earthly success, it should be ordered or it should be submitted not to ourselves, but to God and to others. A life of discipleship is a life of detachment from these lesser goods, and daily prayer helps us to live with this type of perspective. So what Bishop Kevin is telling us here with this short message is that if you want to become an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ, if you want to become an intentional follower of Jesus Christ, if you want to witness Jesus Christ's life, to love and good news through your life, you need to start living a life with a purpose. So one of the many questions that we ask ourselves is, what is the purpose of my living? What am I doing in this earth? What is my purpose? Why do I wake up every morning? What am I called to do? Like, what am I doing here, right? The biggest purpose, okay, you might want to become a doctor, you want to become an artist, you might want to become anything you mentioned. You might want to have a certain profession and live by that, but that's not the end purpose. God has instilled in you a specific purpose for you to serve Him and for you to witness His kingdom and for you to witness His love. And this is what it means to be an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ, meaning you start to think of your purpose. You start to ask God, you start to ask Jesus, I am your disciple, but what is my purpose? What am I supposed to do through this discipleship? And with this purpose simply means, according to our catechism, to know. So the very purpose that we have in this life as disciples is to know, to love, and to serve God in this life, first and before everything else. So we're called to know Him, we're called to love Him with everything that we have, and finally, we are called to serve Him, to serve His kingdom, to serve, to go, and to witness with our life in this life, right? And then to be happy with Him in the eternal one, the one that's coming, the one that we are all awaiting. So I'm going to challenge you today to think to ask ourselves this type of questions. When people see me, do other people see God at work in my life? Or do other people, do my fellow classmates, fellow friends, fellow brothers, parents, family members, do they see God at work when they see my life? Do they see God when they see me? Do they see His actions when they see me? Do they see goodness and generosity and mercy in my life? Do they see a mean person, an evil person, a person that doesn't want the good part, or do they see generosity, goodness, mercy, and love in us? Can they recognize that we are disciples of Jesus Christ by the way we speak, by the way we talk, by the way we behave, by the way we address our opinions, by the way we live our lives? These are the type of questions I want us to take with us home and to meditate upon and to say, okay, I was made in the image of God. That's how God first sees me. And I'm also His child. So He sees me as His child. But hey, He's telling me now that I'm not only His child, but I'm also His disciple. So He's giving me more responsibility. He's giving me more duty. He's telling me you're my disciple and you're supposed to witness generosity, love, kindness, the good news with your life. So can people really see a disciple of Jesus Christ when they see me? Can they see me love them, care for them, forgive them, help them, be caring for them, you know? Can they see Jesus Christ in my life? am I witnessing through my life Jesus Christ? Because when Jesus looks at me, he looks a disciple. He says, listen, you are my disciple. When I got baptized, I became the child of God, the Father, but at the same time, I became also the disciple of Jesus Christ. And with my life, I am supposed to witness this good news. I'm supposed to witness the gospel. I'm supposed to witness the love of God. When people see me, they need to see the love of God. When people listen to me, they need to listen the love of God, the mercy of God. So can people really recognize that I am a disciple of Jesus Christ through my life? If not, what do I need to change? How do I need to change? And all the sacraments that our church has for us, they allow us to become a better fitted disciple. So through confession, by taking the Holy Communion, the Holy Blessed Sacrament, every time, every opportunity that we have, at least once a week, by going to confession at least once a week, by always trying to reconcile with God, and by always trying to seek to hear his voice, we can then try to adjust to become a better fitted disciple of Christ. So next week we are going to look at, okay, if I am the child of God, the disciple of Jesus Christ, then who else I am in the sight of God? And we're going to look that we are also the temple of the Holy Spirit. We will go through that. But for today, I will conclude here with all these questions to you that I would want you to meditate upon. And do you guys have any questions or any opinion? And Abba, if you have anything to add or to also counsel us, I would also want to give you that opportunity.
Let them, those who are attending, let them speak. I really appreciate your teaching, the meaning of discipleship, very important. And we are all called to this discipleship. And we have to just listen to his voice and follow him always.
Amen.
He's saying, follow me, follow me. That is the word of discipleship. We always hear it.
Yes.
Just a few words to add. Maybe I will have also some slides at the end when you have.
Yes.
Yes. Follow me. In Tigrinya, Sa'abani Malatiu, Takatalani, always follow me. As I walk, walk with me. And Jesus is saying, I'm the light of the world. And just follow the light. Get out from darkness. Because there is no other light besides Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
In our daily life, there are many things, ups and downs. There are lights and darkness. So if we follow the light of Jesus, truly, truly, we are following him.
Yes. Okay.
So try to meditate. You mentioned many, many things about the meaning of the gospel and about the topic which you have even mentioned, the bishop. All this is very, very important. So if you have any question, please ask to FERUZ, and I will also...
I have one question.
Yes, please. Yes, go on.
It's just John chapter 3, it says, truly, truly, I tell you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And then it emphasizes saying, unless, truly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. What does that mean?
Abba, do you want to go ahead and answer this one, or do you want me to try first?
Yeah, try it, please. Then I will add something.
Okay, so what Jesus Christ is trying to tell here to this man that asked him, oh, what do I need to do in order to gain the eternal life, right? So what Jesus Christ tells him is, unless you're born again, you will not enter the kingdom of God. But born again, like what? He was puzzled. He says, do you want me to go back again to the womb of my mother and come out again? Is that possible? Like, I'm old now. And Jesus Christ says, no. You have to be born of what? Of the water and the spirit, which is exactly what we do through our baptism, right? When we get the first type of, like, the first birth is when our mother brings us to this world, right? That's the very first birth that we have. So we get born once. But Jesus Christ says, no, you need to be born again, which means you need to belong to the kingdom of God. You need to become, the children of God. You, because of Adam and because of Eve, you have lost the grace from God. And in order to be restored back to that, you need to be baptized. You need to be born again. And for you to be born again, you need to deny all the works of the evil. And you need to say, I believe to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, and to everything that the church teaches us. And so in that, we become what? We become the family of God. And that's the second birth, right? That's the born again. So during our baptism, what does our priest does for us? When the baby comes with the mother and the father, what does the priest does? He blesses them. He blesses the child. He pours on the water, and he breathes into the child, and he calls upon the Holy Spirit so that it falls. And at that specific moment, Holy Spirit, just like Holy Spirit came when Jesus Christ was baptized, at that very moment, Holy Spirit dwells within that child, and that child is then born again and is then now welcomed into the family of God. And so that's what Jesus Christ is telling him. Unless you come back again through this way, you cannot be family of God. You cannot come to the kingdom of God. Because listen, when your mother brought you to this world, you are still in the sin of Adam and Eve. You are still with sin, but you have to be delivered from the sin. And for you, the only way to do that is through baptism. And this is a very deep topic that we will go through our catechism. But it is basically, for me, this specific chapter or verse is talking about baptism, how important it is. And it is, of course, coming to this world. You know how we celebrate our birthday, which is the day that we came to this world? But I prefer to celebrate the day that I was baptized, because that's the actual birthday for me, because that's when I became that's where I belong to family of God. That's when I know, okay, now I belong to the kingdom of God. So I think that's how I would respond to you, yes, to that, Betu. But I also, please, Abba, please, counsel.
That's an important and crucial question, especially our young people.
Yes, yes.
Again.
Yes.
We have to translate always the Bible in the correct way, because we miss the correct meaning. We have all already born in flesh from our parents. But there is another way to be born. That is what Jesus is saying to Nicodemus. You have to be born again in water and the Holy Spirit. And that is, in brief, the baptism, the new life, the new birth. What happens when we are entering into the water? We sink. If you don't breathe, you will die. Have you ever tried to swim? If you swim, if you just go down to the water, what will happen? If you don't, for example, if you don't, you are not trained well to swim, you will be sink down, you will die. So in other words, we go to the water to die in our sins. And when you are waking up to the life, you just breathe and you will have a new life. And that is why Jesus goes to the water, to the Jordan River, in order to be baptized. So everyone, every child, when he is baptized, he is reborn. That is what we call the new birth. I don't know if I have explained it for you. There is a lot of other things which goes hand in hand what we call this spiritual rebirth, spiritual. I can explain it in Tigrinya if you want. Sigawi mulad nivlo kawoladna nwuladay. Hadogalai wulad bsiga. The harigin men fesawi mulad zbahala lo bitimkat ndeganantayn khowen nwulad. Etu ola'a kitimma unkollo. Dropso tsegallo. Tikulluna adam hatiat ntayn khowen idimses. All the original sin is completely destroyed. It will not be happen, but he is going to be born again. Hand in hand, I want to explain for you one thing, and I am going to ask you, I'm going to challenge you, especially those who are attending. What is the difference between redemption and salvation? Is it the same or different? Who can answer this question? Did you hear this word? Can you hear me? Did you hear it? Is there any difference between redemption and salvation?
Naomi, Betty, Ruta, come on, try. Lulia, try your best.
Go on, Lilia. We don't hear because...
Lulia, you are muted, yes.
Okay. Is it salvation?
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember the other ones.
Redemption.
Okay. Redemption. And I think that's it.
It is a bit hard. It's a bit hard. You need just...
I think... Redemption and salvation means being saved from your sin.
Do you think it's one thing, or do you think there's a difference in the two words?
I don't think there's a difference. I think they both mean like being saved from your sin.
FERUZ.
Okay. I do believe there is a difference in the two terms. I don't exactly know the big difference, which I'm very excited to learn today with you. But I do know that salvation, redemption is, I have been redeemed. I have what I have lost, now I have got it back again. It's what it means. Salvation is, which I also think like, bit right. I thought it was the same. It has similar meaning, but it is maybe being saved. Redemption is from my original thing. I have been redeemed. I have been restored. I am to be saved.
Yes.
From the current one. Yeah.
Yes, you are quite right. Just explain it very briefly, very shortly. There are two different words. Even though they have the same mission, but they are very different. We are all redeemed by the blood of Christ. We are all. But still, we are in the process of salvation because we are still alive and God is giving us time again and again to repent and to be back to Him, to save it. Because our salvation is not in this earth, our salvation is in heaven. One day we will be saved. But if we are keeping the rule, okay? For instance, we are living in a very tough moment. They are asking to wear a mask, to sanitize. Just that is temporary. But if you don't respect the rule, you are just putting your hands on the fire and you will be burned. So we have to save. Yes, save temporary with doing mask and sanitizer. But if we want to be saved totally from our life, we have to be back to God. We have to return to Him. Yes, Jesus Christ has redeemed us 2,000 years ago. But we are not saved. We should have to pray because our faith needs practice. Our faith needs action. And that is why we go to the church to worship him, to receive his sacraments in order to be finally to enter to heaven, which means salvation. I don't know if I have explained it. So there are many people who are speaking about reborn, if you are not reborn, and so on and so on. Tell them, yes, I am reborn by my baptism, but I am not saved. I have to work hard to be saved by my faith, by keeping praying, by asking forgiveness and mercy. Above all, we Catholics, we have the sacrament of Eucharist by receiving his body and blood. Because Jesus strictly, he has said to us, if you don't eat my flesh, if you don't drink my blood, you will not have eternal life. So we have to keep all this in mind. And thank you and God bless you.
Thank you, Abba. That was very, very clear. I hope it's clear also for you, Naomi, now, and Betu, and Ruta, and Julia. Betu, by the way, your question, was it answered? Or do you still have some doubts? Anything not clear?
Thank you.
Any other question? Or do you want to say anything, Ferus?
I think from my side, I'm fine. I'm very excited to learn this new thing. I think the difference, at least I know how to explain now.
Great.
So there's always, we're always learning and that's what's exciting.
Slide is really important. Something is always very helpful when we need some quotation.
Yes.
I'm going to present it. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, we will have a music to hear. Can you read it?
Yes, sir.
Great.
Thank you.
I think we have finished it. It looks like this, today's slide. You have learned something. I have learned many things today, and may God bless you. Maybe we can have a final hymn, which is prepared by Feruz. If you have any question, please ask before we go to the final closing prayers and blessings. I don't see today Sarah. Is she around?
No, Sarah is not around today. She excused herself.
Okay. So we will pass to the next.
You can manage your team's work easily with Monday.com.
Sorry for this. Yes, now we can pass. Yes. The title of this hymn is Still, Still, Be Still.
Cover
Thank you. Yes, we arrived to the end. Just while I'm here, I just go to search the difference in Tigrinya between redemption and salvation. It's a big difference, even in Tigrinya, okay? Mm. Redemption in Tigrinya, in the dictionary, it says, Eda kefilu adhane. You understand Tigrinya? Eda kefilu adhane. For example, if one body is in prison, let's say, and they send him by a bill, by bell, do we call bell? Something,
yeah.
He goes. So just is saved, temporary, that is to redeem. Or let us say one person is around the big sea and he didn't know how to get out. And they go, those life rescue, and they save him. So this is what we call redeem. Eda kefilu adhane. Who has paid for us? Who has paid for us this to be redeemed? Jesus. Jesus paid his blood to save us. And the other is salvation, completely different. Dehnat, Iblob Tigrinya. Dehnat, completely different. So I will leave you with this and may God bless you. If you have any other question, but we can, I think it's time now to close. And we'll see you next week.
It will be
for this mini seminar. Yes, the same title, I think. Is this the same title?
The same title with last part next week.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Can we say all thank you to FERUZ?
Thank you.
God bless you.
From God.
Say a prayer, FERUZ, and close it, please.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Father, we thank you for today's session. We thank you for what you have taught us today through your word. Father, we know that you have called us to be your children. You have called us to be your disciples. And you have redeemed us through the blood of your Son Jesus Christ. But Father, help us to be true to you, to follow you, to honor you with everything that we do, with our actions, with our words, in every single action we take, so that we are able to see you on the last day, and we are to be fully saved and to be able enter into the kingdom that you have called us enter. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you, Abba, for Jesus offering his time for every person, for Betu, for Naomi, for Julia, and for Rota, for joining in today, and for every person that joined the channel live to participate. Father, I thank you for their life, for keeping them safe, for always guiding them and protecting them with your love and mercy. We offer you our Saturday night and our Sunday. May you use it for glory, and may you help us to understand and meditate upon what it means to be the true disciple in you. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Hail Mary, full of grace.
Blessed art thou among women, blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and for our fathers. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Abba, may you bless us so.
The Lord be with you. And with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you all. Maybe we will conclude with the final hymn, and one hymn which you have sent it. I don't know if it is
available. Sure. Let's get this out.
Yes, here I am.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin. My hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send?
I think we have finished it. God bless you all again.
Thank you, Abba.
Thank you, Abba.
Thank you, everyone. I'll see you next week. Have a lovely Sunday. Bye.
God bless you all. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.